Everyone, my name is Harshita Jain and I'm currently an intern at Lexis & Company. Today, I'm going to talk about share and capital shares. So first of all, shares. Now, this will, in the case of Bachcha Ghosdar versus CIT, it is said that a share is a right of participation in a company's profits when it is going, it is a going concern, and its assets when it is being wound up. Hence, it becomes clear that to raise capital for its own purposes, a company issues shares to the public or private individuals, and in proportion to the shares acquired by them, they acquire rights and liabilities of participation, as well as, you know, rights of like voting and the liability to pay the amount due on share when called on. Hence, in Indian law, a share is also included in the definition of the Sales of Goods Act 1930, which labels both shares and stocks as movable property. Covered under its ambit, Section 44 of the Act categorizes share as a movable property. Now, share capital. The solitary word capital, when used in company law, often refers to the share capital itself. It is not necessary that all companies shall have share capital, although all companies limited by share must have a share capital specified in their memorandum, whereas companies limited by guarantee may or may not opt to have a share capital. Now, I'm going to discuss the different types of capital. First is the authorized or registered capital. This is given under Section 2, Subclause 8 of the Act. Authorized or nominal capital means the capital which is authorized by the memorandum of a company to be the maximum amount of share of the capital of the money. Second is the issued capital. It is given under Section 2, Subclause 50. It means that the capital which the company issues time to time for the subscription, it is that part of the registered or authorized capital which the company issues for public subscription and allotment for the time. This is to be computed at the nominal value. Third, what is a subscribed capital? This is given under Section 2, Subclause 86. This means that the part of the capital which is for the time being subscribed by the members of the company, it is that proportion of the issued capital at face value which has been subscribed for or taken by the subscribers of shares in the company. It is clear that the entire issued capital may or may not be subscribed. The part which does not get subscribed becomes this. Now, what is your fourth category is called up capital. This is given under Section 2, Subclause 15. Called up capital means the part of the capital which has been called for payment. Shares are issued and the people subscribing them are not required to pay at the time. Payment is called from time to time, asking people to deposit the amount as per the shares they have subscribed. Called up capital is that portion of the subscribed capital which has been called up or demanded on the shares by the company. The amount actually, you know, gets paid while it becomes a paid up capital. Now, what is a paid up share capital? This is given in Section 2, Subclause 64. Paid up share capital or share capital paid up means the aggregate amount of money credited as is equivalent to the amount received in the respect of shared issues. It includes any amount credited as paid up in respect of shares of the company, but does not include any other amount received in respect of such shares by, you know, whatever name it may be called. Now, I'm going to talk about the difference between the two. The difference between preferred share capital and equity share capital. Now, preferred share capital, this is the fixed amount or fixed rate of dividend. Whereas, equity share capital depends on the available profits and foreseeable expenditure. The preferred share capital is the dividend paid in preference to equity shares. Whereas under equity shares, the dividend is paid after the payment of preferred shares. The preference is given to preferred shares over equity shareholders at the time of winding up under preferred share, while under equity shares, lower preference for preferred shareholder during winding up. Under the preferred shares, the dividend may be cumulative. Section 47 states that the voting rights of the preferred shareholder are limited than equity holders. These can only vote in case of variation in their special privileges or when their dividend has not been paid up to 2 years. Further, they are entitled to vote on the resolution of winding up of a company. Under equity share capital, the dividend is not cumulative and the equity shareholders may vote on any and all the issues. Now, the preferred share capital, no bonus or rights shares are issued, whereas in equity, bonus or rights shares might be issued to the existing shareholders. The voting right of a preferred shareholder is calculated with respect to his share in the total preferred share capital only, whereas the voting right of an equity shareholder is calculated with respect to his share in the total equity share capital only. Now, I'm going to also discuss debentures. What are debentures? Another way of raising money by the company is to borrow money in return for interest. A security that the borrowed sum will be repaid is issued in the nature of a debenture. Thus, a debenture is a tool used by the company to raise the borrowed capital in exchange for fixed rates of interest. The money lender in this scenario is called creditor of the company. According to Section 2, subclause 30 of the Companies Act 2013, debenture includes debenture stock, bonds or any other instrument of a company evidencing a debt, whether constituting a charge on the assets of the company or not. It covers both secured and unsecured debentures. Now I'm going to discuss the types of debentures. First, on the basis of convertibility. Number one, non-convertible debentures. These instruments cannot be converted into equity shares. They will retain their debt character only. Second, partly converted debentures. A part of these instruments can be converted into equity shares in the future at the notice of the issuer. The issuer decides in which ratio the conversion is done, usually at the time of subscription itself. Third, under this category comes the fully convertible debentures. These debentures are fully convertible into equity shares at the issuer's notice. The issuer decides the ratio of conversion. Upon the conversion, the investors enjoy the same status as any ordinary shareholders of the company. Now, fourth and the last is optionally convertible debentures on the basis of conversion. The investor has an option to convert these debentures into shares at a price decided by the issuer or agreed upon the time of issue. Then comes on the basis of redeemability. First, redeemable debentures. These are the debentures which are issued with a condition that they will be redeemed at a fixed date or upon demand or after a notice or under a system of periodical drawings. Debentures generally are redeemable and on redemption they can be reissued or cancelled. Then second under this category is perpetual or irredeemable debentures. Are debentures in which no time is fixed for the company to pay back the money is an irredeemable debenture. The holder of debenture cannot demand repayment till the company is a going concern and does not make default in payment of interest. After the commencement of the Companies Act of 2013, a company cannot issue perpetual or irredeemable debentures. Then comes on the basis of registration. registered debentures. A company the debenture when issued to a specific person's name, mentioning such name on the certificate and the register, creates a registered debentures. Then what is a bearer debenture? On the contrary, debentures may be made out to bearer, making them freely transferable by delivery and entitling its bearer to the amount at the time of redemption. Bearer debentures are negotiable instruments, and the person holding it is a holder, and in due course under the Negotiable Instrument Act, he is thus entitled to receive the principal and the interest thereon. This was seen in the case of Calcutta Safe Deposit Company Limited versus Ranjit Mathura Das Sampath. Last category is on the basis of security. Under this come two subsections, secured debentures and unsecured debentures. Secured debentures are those secured by a charge on the fixed assets of the company issuing it. This was stated under section 71 of the subclause 3 of the Companies Act. They provide that secured debentures may be issued by a company subject to such terms and conditions as may be prescribed by the central government through rules. Second, unsecured debentures. If the issuer defaults on payment of the interest or principal amount, the investor has to be in the same standing as the other unsecured creditors of the company waiting for the payment. These are also called naked debentures. So that's all for today. If there's anything, any doubts, do mention them in the comment box. I'll be happy to answer them.